of five field goals in the last 3 minutes of the half to increase their cushion. And Kevin Jones was smiling. He's got 8 points off the bench.
As you said, some folks watching from his hometown in Mount Vernon, New York here. West Virginia, kind of a tale of three halves, I guess is the best way to put it. How about this?
A fake play on the inbounds. Rutgers was pretending they were going to the right, and West Virginia fell asleep. They're going to the left.
Wow.
That's one you can use in your AAU games when you coach your junior high team.
I like that. Hang on, I'm writing down. Foul call on the inside. Take a look again.
Yeah, right here, they were pretending they were going the other way. The lineup was typical of a play that was going to the right. Instead, Fred Hill buys a basket for his team.
And off the miss. Chance to get it down to single digits again.
This is where the Scarlet Knights struggle, I'm afraid. Right here in the half-court defense, 5-on-5. Here they make a nice play, but of course a charge. Ruoff in the right place at the right time.
And Pett is going to get called for it. His first.
Ruoff came out of the double team, then in position to take the charge. That's an intelligent play. I'm surprised Ebanks didn't go on that one, huh? A little 3-on-3 action.
Yep.
They're back to the funky defense again. Watch Rosario denying Bryant. Butler being played man-to-man by Pettis.
That's one way to beat it.
One of the 4 and 5 men are going to be open. And the 4 and 5 men on this team are interchangeable. Ebanks, Wellington, Smith, Kevin Jones. They can make that 15-foot jump shot. They just got to find the spot.
Looks like they've located where those are. And inside, it's going to be a trip to the free throw line. Gretchen Ike.
Freshman on freshman there, the thin variety in the person of Ebanks and the heavier variety in the person of Gregory. Showed a nice left hand there and a nice jump shot going into the, nice jump stop going into the lane.
He's a product of Venezuela, played his high school ball not far from here at St. Benedict's. Summers back led the Venezuelan junior national team to a second place finish in the South American Championships. Back down to a 10-point game. He's got 8.
Freshman on freshman right here with Rosario on Bryant as well. A lot of young players in the game.
Well, youth is served. Again, that was another way potentially to beat that funky zone defense. Clearly something that West Virginia worked on in the locker room at halftime. Off the inbound. And you know, Sean Butler.
Inbound plays along the baseline and on the sideline are things you work on all the time, usually shoot arounds the day of the game, once the season, and they can be very, very dramatic in the outcome of games. You know, 2 or 3 plays like that, about 5 or 6 happen typically in games. You can get a lot of points on the board by executing.
And a foul call going to come on Bryant, his second. I didn't do anything.
Well, Trek Bryant earlier in the year, he's getting all kind of minutes because Joe Mazzulla is out, the normal starting point guard, shoulder surgery, gone for the season, the star against Duke in the NCAA tournament last year. Talked to Joe before the game. 3 more weeks in that cast that he's got on, that sling.
Now Ebanks looking ahead. Bryant can't hang on to it, but got the save. And Ruoff inside can't hit it. Got his own rebound.
When you drift toward the basket, notice where that miss was, back of the rim, right? When you drift toward the basket, good idea to use the backboard.
Ruoff again. There you go. Leads back up to 15 points. So all that work that Rutgers did, and coming back from 17 down, it's almost all gone again. And Ruoff from the outside has 10 for the game. And answering right back, Anthony Farmer.
I was making the point about Missoula, and right here, Bryant running the show. Early in the year, he was playing way too many minutes for his experience and so on. Now Ruoff plays point sometimes, and that changes things.
There is Missoula. As you said, still wearing that sling. Going to be a little while longer.
He's a great, great kid. He's a very positive attitude about the situation. And there was some time during the year where they thought he might come back, but finally had the surgery and gone for the year. He will be a vital part of this team next year. He and Bryant together will make a very, very nice combination of guys in the backcourt as point guards.
Take a look at this roster by class. Only one senior, it's Alex Ruoff. So everybody is back next year. It's going to be a good team.
And none of these guys who are underclassmen are NBA style players that would likely go early in the draft. So nice way to build a team. And the structure of their personnel is a lot of 6'7", 6'8 guys who can play multiple positions. They can switch on defense on the perimeter. Everybody goes to the offensive boards. It's a very, very interesting team.
Kind of a hallmark of the way Bob Huggins likes to load his roster.
Yeah, and you know, a lot of the Cincinnati teams, I think, is probably what you're thinking about.
Yep.
They had similar kind of personnel situations. You know, you talk about teams going to the offensive boards. They have four players who were bunched up with offensive rebounding. Butler, 54, Ebanks, 56, Jones, 50, and Smith, 54. Four guys with that number of offensive rebounds is highly unusual. Usually have one guy who's got a lot, and then it drags after that.
Gerard Griffin, who got the start in today's game. Draining that one, getting his team back to within 11. He's got six, pair of three-pointers. Junk defense has been let go for the time being. Back to straight man for Rutgers. They've struggled with this man defense against West Virginia. Got the stop there, but can't get the rebound. And Ebanks got rejected. Three shots at it, and now a little volleyball out to Rosario.
Nice defense by Rutgers in the paint. Very, very active. Should have been an easy two for West Virginia. No give up. Steal here.
Crowd does not like what they're seeing. A foul call. I believe that the crowd is upset and Fred Hill is upset that that foul call is a reach on Farmer. If so, that would have been a very, very late whistle. If not, it's on Ruoff and it's Rutgers' possession.
Well, that's what I thought he called, but I might be mistaken. I thought that the steal was made and Ruoff fouled, and of course Fred Hill upset that they didn't have the two.
So did I.
We'll see what happens here.
Well, going to sort it out during the timeout. We'll let you know when we come back with 15:31 left to go, and Rutgers trying to continue the comeback.
Well, the foul was on Alex Ruoff, Scott, and I trust your judgment, my friend. You were right on this call. The steal was made. We're going to show it to you right here. Ruoff handling the steal, and right there he grabs the arm. And as a result, that is a foul. Now, the official points to the right. He's just pointing the direction that the call is going. Nicely done.
Tell you what, during the timeout, it was like we were in the pre-information age. People were saying, who is it on? Two white? No, 22 blue. No, two white.
I trust your eyes.
Right now, Rutgers try to trust their offense, and it just got sent back the other way by Smith.
Well, you know, Coburn is one of those guys who likes to take it. He's a very small player, and he loves to drive to the basket and use the bounce. Best way to defend him is wait for him until he gets to the paint. He's coming. And then use your size to do that.
Coburn's into trouble. And now, just bouncing it off the hands of Griffin. It's a turnover for Rutgers.
Another special situation. Remember a minute ago, Bob Huggins' team executed a perfect play on the sideline for a basket. This is a perfect defense on the sideline inbound play.
And how much of your time does that end up taking in terms of practice?
Just, it doesn't take, 15, 20 minutes, and day of the game, you go over those kind of things. It can mean a lot.
Clearly, as you were talking about also, when you get to tournament play, possession by possession, as you were mentioning. Once again, that's going to be offensive interference, no basket, but, West Virginia, the team crashing the offensive boards, they just can't get it to fall.
Yeah, and Ebanks, looked like he got a flat tire on that, didn't he? I mean, he was going hard to the basket, didn't get any kind of elevation. I think he's a guy who fatigues a little bit, doesn't have great strength yet. Nice switch right here, Alan Rosario. See the mismatch?
But again,
they don't care.
A lot of interchangeable parts for West Virginia.
I think a foul both ways right here.
That's what it looks like in the battle that was going on. I'll tell you what, that's Jim Burr, the official making that call, and Jim is not going to take a whole lot of flack in a situation like that. Obviously a very experienced Final Four official, and he was emphatic.
A lot of action. Welcome to the Big East, everybody. This is some stuff that happens, but when they get tangled up like that in arms, there's going to be a foul called, and you want to decelerate that kind of action if you can, if you're wearing a striped shirt. Those kinds of things can get worse and worse as a game goes on and lead to fisticuffs later on. So you mentioned Jim Burr's name, one of the best. Took care of that nicely.
So Butler and Echenique each get a foul, and possession stays with Rutgers. Trying to cut in this 9-point lead, and they do on the runner from Goldberg.
I tell you, the guy loves the bounce. He takes it to the basket. Just wait for him back there because he is coming, and so is Rutgers right now.
Hear the noise starting to bubble up here at the rack. You're going to get a push off, a ward off. Rosario gets a second. He's been quiet offensively. They did a good job of pounding him and denying him the basketball, even 20, 25 feet from the hoop.
Yeah, scouting report stuff, right? Know what to do. Switch on him every time he comes off the screen. You have long players on him, bigger guys than he is.
Butler got it from the baseline.
Mismatch right there. Butler on Farmer. Farmer giving away about 6 inches on that one.
So Butler's got 8, averages 18. Backdoor cut may have been there. Rosario instead backed up to the corner.
Nice defense. Look at Butler guarding Rosario. Good challenge. He makes it anyway, huh?
Good defense, better offense.
Yeah, right.
12 for Rosario. 6-point game, and now Summers standing.
Mismatch at this end. Farmer trying to guard Butler. Butler should go inside, try to get a pass in there, right like he's doing right now. Farmer fronting.
Coming through, that's a nice post up by Darryl Bryant, all 6 foot of him.
Yeah, and they call him Truck, and you can see why on that particular play. Very physical for a guy his size.
Farmer, and the defense fall down, and that'll be goaltending.
Anthony Farmer.
Well, the action's certainly picking up here in the second half.
Yeah, and Rutgers doing a much better job of executing their offense, using the dribble drive to the basket. Notice how Echenique gets his body in front of people right there, clearing the way. Drives to the basket have been effective in the second half.
Seems to be the best way to attack it if you're the Scarlet Knights. And a hold on Rosario. So for the second time in 3 trips down the floor, he was called for the foul. That's his 3rd.
Yeah, and inexperienced freshman player. He's signaling over the coach that he does not want to come out.
He can signal all he wants.
Sorry, Mike. He'll be back in shortly. He's only got 3. 2 more to go. You like the competitiveness, though, don't you?
Sure. You got to make sure he's around for the end of this ball game.
Yeah.
Rutgers coming coming out and defending. 40 feet from the hoop.
Yeah, doing a nice job, really. Back into the funky defense again.
Oh! Bowers the miss. And a tipped rebound coming all the way out to Inman. Get into the hands of someone who's a ball handler, and Rutgers will set the offense. 6-point game. Close as they've been in a while. Crossover by Coburn. Shot clock now down under 10. That's a great move to the inside. Everything but the basket for Inman. And now the other way, Bryant. And the finish is not there. End to end. Jackson is open. That's an explosion shot if it goes. Crowd was poised to erupt. That's a deflation shot, and that didn't go.
Except Wellington Smith knew where the rebound was coming. Misses from that side, rebound on the opposite side. Nice, intelligent rebounding.
A good offensive rebounding team. Ebanks.
Wrong guy shooting the ball.
Again, an offensive rebound, but a pickpocket job by Chandler. And suddenly, nobody can hit. And it's going back the other way. And the ball to West Virginia when we come back. A lot of trips up and down the floor with no payoff here in Piscataway. This game is being produced and distributed by ESPN Regional Television.
Well, Rutgers shot 52% against Villanova in their last game, but had 20 turnovers. Right now, they are shooting 63% in the second half, and it's been the dribble drive that has helped them. And as a result, they're right back in this game.
It's a 12-4 run after they trailed by 14 points. A little bit more than 5.5 minutes ago.
Stabilizing guy right back in the game right now, Ruoff. He's been on the bench for quite a while. They will run their offense better with 22 in the game. Bryant out, lack of experience. Ruoff running the point. Ebanks, he's out front handling the ball. He did this against Pittsburgh when Ruoff was in foul trouble. How's this for a 6'9 point guard?
Yeah, it works. And another offensive rebound.
The value of offensive rebounding, huh?
Well, when you get two, maybe three shots each time down, you get a pretty good chance of scoring.
That's why I think Duane Blair is the best player in this league.
And that's going to be a foul call back the other way. It'll be on Flowers.
A little bit of a moving screen by Mr. Flowers.
Golf fans and club pros, registration for the 2009 ESPN National Golf Challenge already underway for courses and teams in the Gross, Net, and new 55 and older senior division. For more information, log on to ESPNGolf.com.
Well, first possession of 1-3-1 zone defense by West Virginia right here, Scott. The shots will be in the corner if you can get the ball there. They are a long, long team.
It stays the same way, flicked over the sideline by Ruoff.
I like the idea right here. Fred Hill did this to West Virginia in the first half. His change of defense was very effective. Dribble penetration would be the likely antidote right here for Rutgers.
Right now they've got no way in. Bounce pass worked. No shot, but the foul call on the floor. It's going to be on Wellington Smith, his first.
That is smart fouling. You foul because you're not in the penalty yet, and as a result, no shots taken, no layup taken. Rutgers merely gets the ball on the end line.
Very few foul shot in the first half, and here in the second as well, but from here on in, both teams will be shooting, as each will be over the limit with their next.
Look how far spread out the floor is right now because of the 1-3-1 zone. fix your eyes on the length of the West Virginia players.
Coburn in, got the shot up quickly. And the putback goes for Edmund. 4-point ball game.
Inman, 8 points as a freshman, 12 as a sophomore, 12 as a junior, 5 this year only. Coming up big here.
More and more noise in the building. Smith, hard to the inside, shot got changed. That's going back the other way. Njai fired up. Smith gets back-to-back fouls. That puts West Virginia up over the limit.
Nice action around the basket right here. Notice how Njai did not get knocked under the basket like thin guys sometimes do. He's fired up about that particular play. As we mentioned, only 12 block shots in 13 Big East games. Previous to that in the non-conference season was doing great things blocking shots.
His fifth all-time coming into the game on the Rutgers all-time shot blocking list. However, the miss right there is Rutgers trying to get back within three for the first time since this was a 5-2 game. Joined us late 21-4 for West Virginia to start it. And Rutgers has been slogging uphill the rest of the way. That's not the right shot for Proby, who was 0-for-7 from three-point land as he took it. Big one there, a little too strong for Chandler.
Both teams are not doing a good job of getting the proper shot for the right guy on the team, and Bob Huggins sees that. He's gonna get a timeout, and I guarantee you they're gonna get a quality shot on the next possession.
That's what they're after here in a 4-point game. Tournament. Now, once again, there'll be some fluctuation in that RPI over the course of the next couple of weeks, but right now, this is clearly a tournament team.
Well, when you watch them, they pass the eye test, don't they? I mean, they're big time right there.
There's your flip-flop of shooting percentages by half. They have gotten cold here, and Rutgers has gotten better looks at the basket as they climb back to within four.
They're in that special defense again. The good thing about this is Njai's close to the basket should be a shot-blocking or shot-changing force. Just passing on the perimeter doesn't get it done. That was the shot they made in the first half. Quick hands underneath, huh?
Quick hands resulted in an easy bucket and a stretch of the lead to six. Ebanks with six.
Njai's holding his right arm down on the side. I think he hurt himself on that play. Maybe elbow hit the funny spot.
They are not even getting a touch for Rosario. Bounce pass off the hand of Chandler. But it'll back the other way. Oh, wait a second, we might get an overrule now.
A little discussion going on down there. Jim Burr saw it another way.
Yep. Jim Burr saw it another way. Came a long way to say that, but indeed, that's what's going to happen. It's staying that way when we come back. 7:13 left to go. Njai fighting his way on the inside. Walks away with a grimace, and his team down by six. On the benches, Rutgers will get the basketball back.
Well, their best offensive team is when they have three perimeter guys and sometimes four perimeter guys in the game at the same time. Right here, going with some experience with Inman in the game, last year's leading scorer and rebounder.
Look at the numbers, startlingly similar on both sides. Nice use of the left hand by Rosario as he gets his team back within four.
14 points for the freshman, huh? He averages 17. Best among all freshmen in the Big East Conference, third nationally.
Some pretty heady numbers as you talk about what the future of this Rutgers team looks like.
The shot inside the top of the key has been available against this defense.
So it's that baseline shot. But Rutgers wins the race to the loose ball after the miss. It's Colbert. Blocked away. count that?
No, it's a foul.
Wow. Eubanks went up, got it. Pinned on the glass.
Well, right here, Fred was thinking that it was above the rim, and it was not. It was a good foul because it would have been a breakaway layup for West Virginia. Instead, Eubanks has to earn it at the free throw line, where he is only 61% on the year. Good action on the glass by Eubanks, huh?
That's tremendously athletic play.
This guy's going to be a very good player, but you can see, look at his arms right here. He is a very thin player. 6'9", long, lean. Numbers tonight, pretty good. But when he gets into the weight room and understands the value of strength, his game is going to improve dramatically.
Especially in the Big East.
Yeah, he has a good feel. Multi-skilled type of guy. You know, he can play on the perimeter and inside.
You got to be strong to play in this conference, getting beat up as much as you do on a game-by-game basis. Wears on you after a while. You'll find a bunch of sophomores who will say, you know what, I never understood how much I was going to get kind of knocked around and how much it took to get me ready to play a season, to have the stamina. You know, start talking about the weight training. It's not just about the muscle, it's about the stamina.
Absolutely. Weight training increases your cardiovascular as well.
Off the miss, Rue off the rebound. And West Virginia, which twice now has had this game, it would appear pretty well in hand.
Ruoff is not getting any shots, and either is Deshaun Butler against this defense. And that is not a good thing for the guys.
Oh. Janike just flicking it away with the left hand. There's Butler's shot. And too strong. But too strong on the inside glass is West Virginia.
Well, Devin Eubanks is getting this rebound. He had 17 rebounds in two separate games this year. And you can see him go right here. He's above everybody else by far because of his length and his hops. Last time, only 1 for 2.
7 points for Eubanks. Product of Long Island City, New York.
Well, at this juncture of a game, there's plenty of time left for either of these to come out with a W. When you're the team that's ahead, poise required, especially at the offensive end. Rutgers, of course, can't panic. What's been good to them is the drive to the basket. Another 1 for 2. Coburn has been very, very good in this game, number 31.
Certainly took a long time for them to get here, but if you told them when it was 21-4, they'd be within 6 with 5.5 to go, they'd have taken it. Coburn. That would have been a big shot. Tipped rebound, though, and covered by Farmer.
Baseline's open.
Traveled and spun his wheels on the way into the lane. And Rutgers going to take a full timeout here. Fred Hill wants to settle him with 5:19 left to go in the game. And the option of taking the 30 or the full, he took the full. Golf fans, Club Pros registration for the 2009 ESPN National Golf Challenge is already underway for courses and teams in the Gross, Net, and New 55 and Older Senior Division. For more information, log on to ESPNGolf.com. That time of year again, right?
Oh, absolutely. Pretty soon you'll be out there smashing those 260-yard drives and putting with accuracy.
Whose game are you talking about?
Well, I'll tell you right here, the band is very, very good here at Rutgers, and if they can get their team going, this would be a big, big upset for the Scarlet Knights. 1-12, West Virginia, of course. These are the players on their team from the New York metropolitan area, all doing pretty well.
There's no doubt, kind of return home for these guys, and number of folks here dressed in West Virginia colors coming on to root on some of their hometown heroes.
Well, you know, for West Virginia, this is a very, very important game on an emotional basis, and good coaching is a part of this kind of deal.
There is Sean Butler's dad, Ira seems to be making a very important point here. It's one that's important. You know, that doesn't look like somebody who's just sitting and enjoying it. That's somebody who's working every possession.
He's saying my son should be getting more shots like most parents do, huh? The point I was trying to make about West Virginia is the importance of this game. It's an emotional thing because the Villanova game was so big for them, a ranked team at home, and they really crushed Villanova. And then they play Notre Dame, who's a team that's not a great team, but very good offensively. So they play those two home games, big emotion, big all. And now they come to Rutgers, which is way down in the standings, and they get off to this great start. And then, boy, I'll tell you, it's been a struggle ever since for them. This is a very, very important game. They do not want to lose to Rutgers or DePaul or any of the teams near the bottom of this league. That could send negative vibrations out, huh?
And it's also the first of basically what is a three-game road trip, in quotes. Three away from what is a very friendly place to play back in Morgantown.
Yeah, they're going to be at Cincinnati and at South Florida in their next two.
Got the basketball and a six-point lead as we come up on 5 minutes left.
Should have shot it.
I think he thinks the same thing. He will shoot it. Jones doesn't hit it. Good position on the rebound for Griffin.
Boy, a lot of hesitancy on the part of those guys out front on that shot that really was very good to them at the end of the first half.
Wow. Echenique tried to go up strong. And just too many long arms there in front of the basket.
We haven't had Ruoff take a shot in it seems like forever. Rosario doing a nice job denying him. That's the shot they need.
And that's the shot they hit. Wellington Smith draining it. And just inside the top of the circle, he's got eight.
He who hesitates is lost in shooting. So when you get that shot, and you know that's where you're supposed to shoot it from, you get your rhythm. As soon as your rhythm is off, you make silly plays. A lot of misses recently for the Mountaineers from that spot.
Looping pass. Echenique never should have brought the ball down. But there's going to be a reach-in foul on Ruoff, and that is going to be his fourth.
Well, Darryl Bryant is likely to come in the game for Ruoff, although a guy with his experience could probably finish the game without getting his fifth. They do decide to take him out at least momentarily.
Just two field goal attempts this half for Ruoff, and the foul right here.
Well, he clearly grabbed him by the arm.
9 points down for Echenique. One more time here at the free throw line.
For a guy who shoots 66%, he's got pretty nice form, doesn't he? The rotation is nice. Elbow out a little bit to the side, which is a problem.
3 for 4 here on the day from the line. So the lead remains at 7 now with 4 minutes left.
Kevin Jones is wide open.
So Smith from exactly the same spot.
Well, that was the place where they made that run at the end of the first half. Made a bunch of shots from that exact spot, huh?
Remember Wellington Smith being told by his head coach where to go on the floor to shoot the basketball? Apparently he heard him. And now Butler reaching in nearly creates the steal and apparently does. That would have been wildly unpopular if it stood, but John Cale's coming over and I think he got an overrule coming. Nope. It will be a wildly unpopular call. 14th turnover for the Scarlet Knights. You decide on the play on the sideline. So the ball belongs to West Virginia. They got a 9-point lead. They got the basketball back after somewhat controversial call. I tell me, Coach, what do you think?
Well, I see a lot of guys hustling. I see arms everywhere. And when this ball goes out of bounds, watch what everybody does. Wasn't me. Wasn't me. Everybody's hands up in the air.
Watch Echenique coming right in here on the side of your screen.
Yeah,
right there.
I think he's the guy who touched it last.
I think it's a good call. Not me. Me. Kind of like when you go down to the basement, and you realize there's some problem coming from the kids. You walk down, wasn't me.
Nice. Two guys in the spots where the shots are going to come from. Smith and Jones playing back and forth. One guy has to guard the two of them.
This was a 4-point game with under 7 minutes to go, but West Virginia has held Rutgers down to a single point on what is now almost four full minutes. Wow. Crowd again looking for a call. They have blocked shots on the inside. Rutgers hasn't had a whole lot of easy looks in there here in the second half. And there's a big hit by Butler. You got to think right now that this game is clearly in West Virginia's hands.
And you know, Butler is a guy who's been pretty silent for his level of play in this one. Wide open on that one.
Well, he's got 11 and now might be out of options here if you're Fred Hill.
Wellington Smith goes way up in the air to get that one. And then the coaches are saying slow down. He has so much time. He can even get the seams right on this one. He's never been that open in the course of his career.
That was amazing. He actually had time to go look down to find the spot on the ball that he wanted to be holding as he let go of it.
I'll tell you, he's been a terrific player this year. You know, Dewan Blair, Hasheem Thabeet get a lot of notoriety in this league, deservedly so, and so does Jarrell McNeil, who I think is maybe going to be the most outstanding player in the league. But Butler is among the top guys, no doubt about it.
Rutgers running out of time. They need a few of those, and they need them to go. Bryant breaking on through the defense. As we said, the game clearly in the hands of West Virginia right now.
Well, you know, one of the things is you do your math on how far you are ahead and how many minutes are left in the game. Sometimes you see teams taking the air out of the ball, which West Virginia is doing right now, too early. And when you do that, you risk the other team getting right back in the game. And I've seen that a lot in college basketball this year. When things are going great, you just keep on playing. But I think this is wise on their part at this juncture.
They lost the ball, but they just took a lot of the time that Rutgers hadn't left. We're down to 140 to go.
Right. Wasn't a bad possession, wasn't it, because of all the time that went out.
Tell you what. You'll see that from time to time. Rosario good at it, got Jones off his feet. Something that Scotty Reynolds from Villanova will do at least once a game.
Yeah, and if you're going to block a jump shot, which rarely ever happens, stay on the floor until the other guy goes up. The ball fake is what got Jones off his feet. Sam Young, of course, another player in this league that uses that move very, very efficiently.
Rosario, the guy you want at the free throw line, the leading free throw shooter in the Big East. Time he has been there here this afternoon. And this.
More ball handling in the game for Bob Huggins. Ruoff back in with four fouls.
And free throw shooting as well, just in case.
Right, exactly. Good point.
Now, yeah, once again, I didn't get the impression that Rutgers was fouling at this point. And a two for Rosario.
The margin is maybe a little too much for that particular strategy.
And a quick timeout here. The Scarlet Knights. Situations like this, Bob, in your years as a coach, whether it's 13 with a minute and a half to go or not, are you using this as an opportunity to not only take this game, but to teach and move ahead to the next game and years beyond?
Yeah, I don't think there's any question about that. What do you do in this kind of situation? Instead of 13, it was 5. Well, you go full court, you deny everybody inbounds, you try to get a 5-second count if you can. Now, sometimes you guard the ball, sometimes you take 5 guys to play 4 on the inbounds, and that's a good way to get a 5-second count. We'll see how they handle it.
We said preparing for the future. This is what that immediate future looks like. Upcoming game at Notre Dame, home against Providence. And on to Syracuse, South Florida to close it out.
Run. And then the Big East Championship, because everybody goes this year.
Everybody in the pool. So there's your foul call with 93 seconds to go. And West Virginia will have to try to put this one away at the free throw line. Still 1-1, the 19th foul.
3 or 4 games remain for each team in the Big East Conference. Yet to be determined is who will be the top 4, who will get double byes in Madison Square Garden. who will be the next four who will get single buys in the Garden. And of course, the teams at the bottom know they will be playing on Tuesday.
Right now, with a two-game lead in terms of losses, Connecticut, Pitt, Marquette, and Louisville looking very, very good as those top four.
And that is a big, big advantage. And you should have an advantage in the conference tournament if you played remarkably well during the regular season. I kind of like that idea of it.
Especially if you're opening it up to everybody. So, you know, you're trying to have a reflection of what you did during the regular season in the entire of the conference. That's exactly what it is. Here's your new format beginning Tuesday, March the 10th.
Well, 15 games, 5 days, five rounds. You can sort of erase that because I doubt anybody's going to win five games in 5 days. Now, twice in the history of the tournament, I think we've said this many times, two teams won four games in 4 days. Jerry McNamara, the great Jerry McNamara, when he did that for Syracuse. And last year, when Pittsburgh beat Georgetown in the final, they won four games in 4 days. But a rarity, and certainly five games in 5 days would be nearly impossible.
5 games in 5 days to get through the Big East tournament and have it all happen in Madison Square Garden coming from that range. They ought to give you the NCAA title right then and there.
Good point. Or a medal of some kind.
From long range, draining the shot is Chandler. You're still at 12. You still got a little bit more than a minute, and they're going to drag this one out now in terms of making West Virginia make their free throws. And here's what we told you about in terms of the Big East Conference and the standings. Those top four teams in terms of losses. Villanova got a win today to get to 10-4, but as we said, still two out loss column-wise from that coveted top four spot in which you get a bye straight on through to the quarterfinals.
Yeah, and look at the bottom. Providence, Cincinnati. Which one of those teams is going to be the ninth instead of the eighth team? That's very important as well. Ninth team, no bye. You play the first day. Earlier in the year, the ninth team in the league was ranked in the top 25.
It's amazing.
How about that,
huh? Isn't that amazing?
It is amazing. But at that juncture of the year, the euphoria of nine teams in the top 25 eventually gave way to the reality of playing against one another. And of course, only six teams in the top 25 right now.
It was a physical impossibility to sustain it if you're going to be playing each other throughout the month of January, February, and March.
Yeah, mathematically, it's not going to work. Somebody's going to play and somebody's going to lose those games against those ranked teams.
It's a 12-point game now, just under a minute to go. He's still coaching for all he's worth right now is Fred Hill.
I need one.
Again, are you going to come back and win this game? Likely no.
Two.
But are you building a foundation for what you're going to do next game, next week, next year?
Yeah, and I think for a lot of times when it's this far ahead, viewers get annoyed at it and they say, well, why do they do that? And you're explaining it well. That is why that is done frequently. At some point, of course, you call off the dogs and say, okay, this game is over. We practiced that. And let's just let this clock run out. Of course, you don't see this as much in the NBA because their shot clock is much shorter, 24 seconds.
Wow. You cannot get a body on a free throw like that. You got a whistle. Not sure what the stoppage of the clock is. I guess the clock wasn't running. Clock was not running.
Well, what happens is the clock should start. This was an offensive rebound
right. Basket.
So normally, the clock does not, if the free throw goes in, the clock doesn't start until you inbound the ball. Also, the clock starts when some, on a miss, the clock should start when someone touches it, whether it's a rebound or a basket. Now, I think the problem is when it's under a minute in a college basketball game and the ball goes in the basket, stop. So that's where they're messing around with right here.
Right there, it should start. It did not. Now it starts. Now it stops. Now, yep, there you go. It was inverted. Bob Huggins saying, just get me that 56 and a half off the clock.
Get us out of here is what he's saying.
He's going to have an interesting and I would imagine pretty emotional night coming up next time out. Next Thursday at Cincinnati.
He's being honored. The school that he brought to great heights is honoring him when they play that game. It will be an emotional day for Bob. You are absolutely right.
Once again, a situation like that going back again, there's got to be all kinds of feelings that are going to be coming up in terms of fans and Bob. But Bob, for an emotional guy, does keep it at a pretty even keel in terms of what he does on the floor.
Well, you know, he garnered a reputation at Cincinnati as this volatile guy screaming at his players all the time. Certainly a tough guy, but when you're around him, he's not like that at all. And not like that much in practice either. They play hard, though.
I think I saw one of his practices as a timeout is called to preserve the possession. Saw one of his practices for the first time last year at West Virginia. And I was stunned by how, you know, obviously making very strong points, but very low key. Not a lot of histrionics, not a lot of yelling. It's exactly what you would have expected had you read the headlines over the years. Wasn't the case.
Right, exactly. And of course, guys mellow too as they get a little bit older. And he's a good teacher. He was a very, very good player himself. Cerebral type. He said he was a magna cum laude graduate of West Virginia University. So certainly has the brains to take care of and understand things. I think he's a master at the psychological part of the game with his players and keeping them motivated all the time. I think that's very, very important for his coaching resume.
By the way, going to update, make a correction in the standings. Syracuse and Cincinnati both at 7-7.
And, you know, I think Cincinnati's the surprise team in the league. Many people thought that they would be near the bottom three or four teams in the league. They have added a terrific player in Mike Williams, who's playing right now, and they have moved up dramatically.
With 17 games on the season.
Well, West Virginia, we're looking at them at 7-6 on this, but they will be 8-6 in a few minutes. And, of course, they want to be in a position where they are not playing on the first day, and I think that's virtually assured by them looking at the schedule that they have to play in their last four games.
It's pretty clear when you start looking who the top teams are. I'll tell you what, you've got a couple of teams mixed in there that either are playing well right now or teams may have forgotten about, people may have forgotten about. It could get awfully dangerous come Big East tournament time. I mean, don't go to sleep on Georgetown.
Yeah, and Georgetown, you know, two overtime games in a row they lost, and they go down to South Florida and win that game, you know, and then they lose to Marquette, which is a very, very tough team. I thought that after they beat South Florida, Georgetown, if they came home and played well enough to beat Marquette and Louisville in a row, they could be back in the conversation, but I don't think that's going to happen.
Right now, it could be spoiler roll with the Big East tournament for a team that some very high hopes coming into the year. But one way or another, the Big East is going to be very well represented on Selection Sunday.
No doubt about that. Most people, you know, last year there were eight teams from this conference in the NCAA tournament, the most. And, of course, most people who prognosticate and think about this league and who know the league feel that that will be the same number this year.
That is long range and comes up a little bit short. They're going to call off the dogs here, as you were pointing out. That will do it for this game. The West Virginia, which had a big lead early, had to weather a storm. Rutgers couldn't quite get over the hump. And the Mountaineers are going to win their 19th of the year, their eighth in Big East play, as they walk out of here with an 18-point win.
Yeah, and they did it. They got off to a great start. You got to give Rutgers a lot of credit. That funky defense got them back in the game. Second half, the first part of the second half, they shot well, got close within six, but West Virginia is just a little bit better team.
So the Mountaineers get themselves a victory. West Virginia can pack up and head on to Cincinnati. The man who went home again last year gets to go home again this coming week as he'll head back to Cincinnati. Again, our final score, West Virginia 74, Rutgers 56. For Bob Wetzel, our entire Big East Network crew, I'm Scott Graham. Tune in Saturday, a Big East doubleheader. St. John's takes on DePaul at noon, 2 p.m. Number 22, Pittsburgh, taking on number 9, Louisville in women's action. For more information, log on to ESPNplus.com. The preceding has been an exclusive...